Welcome everybody to a new episode of Flower Circus Talks, episode number 101. So, and today, special guest, we've got Tom Vermeer from Xpol. And without further ado, let's get him into the live stream. And there he is, welcome.
Hi.
Hi Tom.
Good afternoon.
Hi. Good afternoon, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good. Yes, really good. Yeah. Thank you.
Before we start, Xpol is supplying to supermarkets. A lot of florists struggle with the prices, with the high prices and the changing market. How is that for supermarkets and their suppliers?
Of course, supermarkets do also face a little bit of that, although normally they buy long term.
Yeah.
But some prices, because some extra demand also came up from the market. So also some of the retailers had to pay extra to get their volume. So there was a game how to fulfill orders and still satisfy the growers.
Yeah, I can imagine, especially with the fixed prices and those things.
Yes.
So quite hard.
Yes.
Before we go further into details, can you explain a bit more about yourself and about Xpol?
Okay, good. Yeah, my name is Tom Vermeer. I'm coming from the Westland. It's a growing area. My father was a grower. I studied horticulture, business. My life has been most of the time in retail supermarkets, but also growers, African growers in the last, I would say, 20 years almost.
Yeah.
Supplying to retail organizations. And before I worked for TFA, Bloom. I started up the company Bloom in 2002. And since, almost 11 years, this month, 11 year ago, we started together with my partner Hans van der Goes. We started the company Xpol.
Yeah. Okay. And can you tell more about Xpol? What does it stand for, and what is it different than other companies? Because I invited you with a reason.
Yes. Good. Now Xpol is coming from the word Xpol is cross pollination. It's cross pollination between supply and demand, and we made Xpol out of that. There always will be a grower. Without a grower, you don't have products, flowers, and there will be a retailer, somebody who sells the flowers to the consumer. And our business model is in fact that we are somewhere in this supply chain. We are involved in supporting this business, in synchronizing, in fact, between the grower and the retailer, and between the retailer and the grower.
Yeah.
And we felt we wanted to have an independent platform for both parties. So we, before when I started Bloom, we were owned by a grower. So there are different models and different companies who start from grower, supply to retailers. We are independent company. We're there for both retailers and growers, but independent.
Yeah. And you already mentioned it, synchronizing. Your slogan is where demand and supply synchronize.
Yeah.
I mean, normally it was a grower producing and then you just had to find a buyer for it.
Yes. Synchronizing, I always say synchronizing is more complicated than buying and selling. Because buying, you just determine the price to a grower. You said this is the price, or you buy on the auction, whatever. But us, we need to find a solution that it will work for a grower, that the grower also has they work on the cost price plus. And whenever there are issues, we find solutions rather than, okay, you are the grower, you sort out your issues, and I've sold it for this price. So you're always on 2 feet, and you cannot just lay back.
Yeah. I mean, it's, I think we have such a long or especially with the traditional flower trade, we have such a long chain. I think a lot of growers still don't know what's happening at the sales part, at the florist, but also at the supermarket, when there's a high demand and when there isn't.
Mm-hmm.
I think you're also saying synchronizing, but also an open communication between the grower and supermarket. I think that's really important. So a grower understands what's happening with his flowers as well.
Yeah, we always believe that we don't order, let's say, product for a market or a customer. We set up a line for a supermarket or for a florist chain. We also supply florist chains. And then we give that to the grower, or the grower is supplying part of it. So the grower always knows where to supply to, but also the customer also knows which grower is supplying to them. So there is they feel more responsible for each other. Also giving more long-term business relationship and commitment.
Yeah, and I think the grower can feel as well if his quality is good, sales are going up. When he has maybe a problem, then he will immediately see it as well or feel it as well.
Yeah, whenever there is a choice to make or whenever there is a priority to give to a customer, we know from experience that a grower will do more to customers who are there for the last 5 years and will be there for the next 5 years.
Yeah, it's all about the business, knowing your customer and knowing where it goes. I think that's really important. It's a pity we didn't have any trade fairs for the last 2 years almost.
Yeah.
But the personal contact, I think if you know as a grower, okay, this is going towards that customer, then you also know more what will work and what doesn't work.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Synchronizing is one thing, packed at source. You're also famous for packed at source.
Yes. Yeah, we started the company with packed at source because we believe that if a grower is packing the product, a grower, first of all, knows much more about their own product.
Yeah.
So they can handle it better. They know how to handle it. So that's one element why we believe in packed at source. The other element is, of course, also when you look, first of all, of course, to the African countries, packed at source, if you add value there, it will be, one end it's cheaper, on the other end it's also better for the community because you add value in these countries. Yeah. And also, whenever you pack product there, you will get the product, the product mix, the color mixes that you need for the final retailer or the consumer. Yeah. So you can really go work out the whole flow from the grower to the retailer. And the let's say the phase in Europe, let's say at our building, is very limited. It's unpacking, putting the flowers on the line, label it, and then it's finished.
Yeah.
So there is less handling, there's less waste in the supply chain. Normally, we overall, for all our packed source product, we work with a waste percentage. It's much lower than 0.5%. But if you would buy a product and start sleeving and packing here, you go to 2-3% easily. The waste stays in the country. So you also don't air freight or don't transport with trucks or the products which you are going to dump.
Yeah.
So that's the ideal situation on packed at source.
Okay. And I can imagine the bouquets are limited but do you see that the assortment is changing because you are doing this as well now? So growers grow more types of flowers?
Yeah. We started our company mainly from Kenya, from East Africa, where we were doing roses and afterwards some spray carnations and some Mona Plus. Now you can see there's more and more different varieties, different crops being grown. So they start making more bouquets. With the combinations which are available. So you can see the growers are reacting on it. They're learning to grow other crops. If you are used to grow roses and all of a sudden you have to start growing chrysant with this climate with with more pest pressure. So it's not easy, but the growers are getting better and better. They also select the varieties. So that's one element. The other element, what we've seen is that also from our strategy is that we also would like to grow more products, more seasonal products, or grow or market them.
Yeah.
So from that area, some of the products we started now packing at our premises.
Okay.
Which is in fact not really what we started. When we started the company, it was packed at source. But now we do already more packed on site because the grower is not able to, or because the grower is only growing one color, and the product is grown by 5 growers to get a full bucket.
Yeah, if especially in Holland, if you see, for example, chrysanthemum growers only have one or two varieties.
Yes.
And the neighbor or another chrysanthemum grower will make up for the assortment.
Yes. So then somewhere it needs to come together.
Yeah.
And that then we refused in the first years, to be honest. We said, no, this is not our thing. But afterwards, yeah, if somebody has to do it, then okay, we'll take up the job.
Yeah. And also Holland, I mean, it's a small country, so shipping it maximum maybe 150 kilometers.
Yes.
It's almost like a local grower in some countries.
Yeah, no, that's true. That's true. Absolutely. Yeah.
Is that also the case why you are building a new premises, or you're going to start to build a new premises because you need more space?
We have been growing step by step. We started with a Dutch grower. He had one office spare, and we started with 4 people in that office, and everything was outsourced, all logistics. And then afterwards we started with an office. We started with a small unpacking facility with one loading bay. Yeah, after, let's say, 11 years, one loading bay is not enough. So we need more space. We also have more machinery. We do different products. So that's the reason that, we can do the next step now.
Yeah, and sourcing worldwide. I think that's also a great thing that happened. You're talking about the optimal chain as well. Your chain is, I already told that the traditional chain is really long, and with all the difficulties that it gets. I mean, as a small child in Holland, we did the game. We whispered something in somebody else's ear, and after 10 people, it was something totally different.
Yes.
And still, I think we got older, and still that's happening, especially in the florist chain. When we travel with Flower Circus, I hear the most crazy stories sometimes because they heard it via. The short chain, I think that's something we should work on more. You already are very experienced in it.
Yeah, what is nice, we always say, let's start when we start supplying a retailer first, or when we start working with a product, I said, okay, let's start, how can we definite the chain? So quite often we just start doing business, and then we start looking at, okay, how can we optimize it? How can we reduce the number of days? How can we reduce the number of handling? For example, Italian products grown in nearby Naples or maybe in Sicily. This whole flow is normally originally is going through San Remo.
Yeah.
After a couple of days, it stays there 2-3 days. Then it comes to Holland. Then it comes to a couple of trading houses, and from there it's going into the market. We sit down with the grower in Naples and in Sicily. How can we get a product straight to us? So then it was finally decided, okay, with 2 drivers, 2.5 days on the truck, then the product is in your house. So we take out at least 4 or 5 days of the value chain, of the supply chain.
Wow.
And then... yeah, if you look and every time we approach it like that, you give more days to the final consumer, because you will see the difference on the shelf.
And I think you can even use different flowers as well, which normally didn't have enough vase life. Because I think most of your customers will work with vase life guarantee as well.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's, you start with something, and it's the same even that we also do the same procedures from Kenya. You first start ordering some roses, and then we organize the packaging materials, or they do pack the sauce. Then we optimize the whole, how is a bucket looking into the box, in the transport box. Then we look at the transport boxes, how can we optimize that area, less handling, manual. You never finished, which is fun.
It really is, because also the flower size, if you have one variety of roses, the head size can be so different. So then maybe less stems go into a box and all those kinds of things.
Exactly.
That's something really strange.
Yes.
You already mentioned it, boxes. Transport is difficult. especially with the air freight. Willy Armolini is online as well. He knows a lot about transport as well. What's happening from Africa, for example? You do a lot of business with Africa.
Yes.
How's the situation at the moment?
On air freight, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes. Now, air freight is extremely bumpy. If you compare the cost of air freight from 2 years ago before COVID and now, it's there is about 60, 65 cents per kilo up on the air freight rate. That's already on the cost side. Even last year, we paid extreme amounts to get our extra production, extra needs out of the country.
Yeah.
And even now, there is still a shortage of freight. So we try to plan, give accurate planning towards the air freight handling companies in a way that they can work on it. They can. We try to be in the continuous flow, to work in the continuous flow from grower to market.
Yeah.
But it's bumpy because the difference, let's say, between supply and demand on air freight worldwide is huge. You know, maybe we pay $2.50 from Nairobi to Amsterdam. But look what's happening from in Asia on the sea freight, but also on air freight, because the product needs to come to, for Christmas, needs to come to Europe or to the States. And there's still a lot left behind.
Yeah, and luckily, Willy is saying this will not get better soon.
No, I believe it will be a half a year at least, and it's bumpy. So even then, it's more important that we don't waste space, and we don't waste flowers. I think that's important.
I mean, like you said already, packed at source will save you 2.5% in the waste, or that means 2.5% in airspace as well. So that makes
exactly
already. Yeah. Willy's also saying flowers are not the best cargo for carriers.
Correct. I think it's in the bottom.
Yeah, it's a lot of handling.
Yes. They're not very much liked. When there was enough airplanes available, then okay, people would move some of their planes into that area. But I hear stories that between $20 and $30 per kilo are paid from Asia to Europe.
Wow.
So yeah, I guess the airlines were all suffering from the crisis. They parked all their planes in the desert, and now they can gain back some of their money. Yeah. Yeah, commercial.
Unfortunately the way it works.
Yeah.
And for us, I mean, the flowers were, as I understood, a bit extra for the air freight carriers as well, because the people were paying a lot for tickets.
Yeah.
And all the flowers that got in the belly, that was just an extra.
Yeah.
And now we really need to pay for the plane to fly all over the world. So that makes a huge difference.
Yeah.
Packing, you already said it. I think that's, I've seen so many pictures. We've been talking to Jeroen van der Hulst as well about packing, that there's still a long way to go because there can be more on the pallet.
Yeah.
You developed a box as well.
Yeah.
Can you tell a bit more about it?
Yeah, we developed this box. There were more people involved, also Jeroen, what you mentioned, and Flora Holland and some other players. We developed also this box, not to be to have our name on it, because that's a side thing.
Yeah.
But to have a standardization, to be able to stack the boxes, to have no plastic in the box, to have no staples in the box, and preferably also no glue. So this is self-locking. We increase the pack rates with the flowers. We pack most of the flowers without SFK, which is protection on the flower heads.
Okay.
So we increasing the number of flowers on an airplane pallet. And within a volumetric kilo, which you pay for. So, and we started this whole process about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
You can imagine it has helped us since the COVID crisis, since the air freight rates also went up. We could still survive because we had our optimization of pack rates and volumetrics and cost. But not even that. Before, still is. In fact, a lot of companies want boxes are going one by one from the grower in a truck, from a truck into the air freight handling agent, from the air freight handling agent on an airplane pallet, and then at destination, again, one by one on a trolley, auction trolley or whatever. The grower is palletizing, is skidding at farm.
Yeah.
And then you get questions from a grower, but then I need to build a loading bay. You say, you need to build a loading bay. How complicated. Instead of having a small door where you can put one box after another through.
Yeah, and especially now with the cost of air freight, I mean, I think everybody is willing to pay almost a grower to build a loading bay, and so he makes a perfect pallet. I think the guys loading the planes, they are fantastic. They're doing a job. It's like stacking all the boxes, but if they have so many different sizes, you're still shipping a lot of air.
Yes, yeah. No, but so... We are quite good now, but it took so much time.
Yeah, it's James Roberts is saying it's way past time for flower box standardization.
Yeah,
we had the discussion already a couple of times with the flower service talks.
Yeah,
everybody thinks his box is the best, and that makes a problem.
Yeah, as long as I think a lot of the boxes are getting to a similar size. It's just more the technique behind folding it or so, but at least you need, at the end of the day, you need to be able to have 6 skids on an airplane pallet on the bottom. If you can do that, then you're okay.
I mean, it's got a question from Willie. He's asking, do you think this crisis will encourage more domestic production?
I think the trend was already, we've seen it, let's say overall in Europe, the rose sales are stabilizing in supermarkets. It depends a little bit on the country, but let's say overall it's stabilizing, it's not growing that much. So there is more demand for seasonal products, more demand for local production. So also less air freight, but also more truck, but also local production. So the answer is yes, there is more demand for local production and wherever you are, for sure.
And it also depends, of course, where you are, if it's possible to even grow flowers at that place.
Absolutely, but also seasons. It's nice in the spring to have a daffodil, or of course tulip market has been extremely expanding over the last year, so people are really, when it's tulip time, they want to have tulips in the house.
And the last couple of years, peonies, I mean, that's unbelievable.
Yeah.
You said an interesting thing, that roses are more or less stable. Do you see, I tend to say to a lot of people, when somebody opens a shop with flowers, doesn't matter if it's a supermarket or a flower shop, you start with roses, because you need to have roses in a flower shop, otherwise you're not a flower shop.
Yeah,
and you have some chrysanthemums because they last very long. That's what we see in the new markets, for example, Russia. Everybody starts with roses and chrysanthemums, and then slowly you will get the seasonal products and other products. Do you think we're at our let's say at our top at the moment with roses in flower shops, and that it only will grow if the total market will grow? Or is there still room to sell more roses?
I think overall there's still more room, but by, let's say, different markets. In some markets, mature markets, you see it's stabilizing. So it's slowly going to an index of zero, so no growth in turnover. But of course, depending on the market, we've seen a couple of years back a trend of going to more tea hybrids.
Yeah,
from the small sweethearts to the intermediates, from the intermediates to the tea hybrids. So we've seen a development on that, or tea or roses together with spray roses. So you can see trends in that level, and depends on the market where you are, with which position you are.
Yeah, I mean, it's unbelievable. It's not that long ago that the first roses came in from Africa, and they were tiny, and everybody was like, we're never gonna, this is not gonna work, and look at where Africa is now.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Willy is saying there are now so many other flowers to choose from that last, especially when you get a short chain.
Yeah.
James Roberts is sharing an article. I will read it after the talks, James. Thank you for sending it.
Yeah.
Another big thing which you already been working on for quite a while is sustainability.
Yeah.
We
put 3-4 years ago we made our own targets on sustainability. We said, okay, what do we want to achieve? Not from a, let's say, a marketing point of view, but from a from an expo point of view, what do we want to achieve in the six elements which you see in the screen: waste reduction, packaging, energy, environment, emissions, and water. And we put targets for 2025, and a couple of times per year we sit down and we come together. So okay, how far are we now? What can we do to improve further? And that's going quite well. Some of them are more successful than others, so far, and we also make of course we analyze, we publish the results, how far we are, and sometimes it's very simple stuff. It's like printing paper, using printers in the office. Before, everybody had their own printer in the office or so, almost literally, and now we see far less printing taking place. But we also see it in waste reduction. Before we had green waste, we had everything in the mixed waste bin, but now we have green waste, general waste, and of course the cardboard, the paper waste, which is now bringing back some money. Yeah. Last we had to pay for, now we get back some money, which is good. So we had some good successes. And also one of the results, of course, with the expo box and the whole handling site is reducing rest paper to transport flowers, but also on the carbon footprint, on the emissions.
Yeah. So what's one of the results you're most proud of?
I would say the paper usage all the way with the box and in combination with the carbon footprint. That has such a big effect. We could not think about it before.
Okay.
It was difficult because to start using less printers in the office is easier.
Yeah.
But that's and the other thing, the second one is waste reduction. Together with a company called Milgrow, we really worked on our waste reduction. How can we do better? And using simple tools, and by registering it, and also by publishing it internally as well as externally.
Yeah, I think that really works. So people see what's happening as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And what are some of the targets for the coming years?
Still about the water management. We have been doing projects with growers on it. So that's one element, and also further on usage of chemicals by flower growers. I know it's not food, but it's still important that we also on that side that we use less chemicals to get the best flowers to the consumers. So these elements, we are on it. We are involved in different projects on that.
Yeah.
It's not finished. It's never finished.
Yeah, but it's good that you're not only looking at yourself, you're also looking at the partners, how to help them to be more sustainable.
Yeah,
I think it's some people still might see it as a trend, but it's sustainable. It, there's no other way to do it, I think, at the moment.
Yeah, it's a continuous process. You're never finished on it.
Yeah, and for florists who want to know more about sustainable and what they can do, the 5th of November, we will have a online show with the theme sustainability. Tiffany van Lente will make sustainable arrangements with recycling, or as she calls it, upcycling with some materials as well. So the 5th of November, so on a Friday, 3 p.m., tune in. Okay. Tom, one other thing is florists can adapt to prices quite quickly. I mean, they can just put other prices in their flowers when they get them.
Yeah.
You supplying to chains, it's way more difficult. And with all the things happening, we talked already about the air freight. We haven't discussed the energy prices, but they are going up as well. Most of the contracts, as I can see, are for a longer period, sometimes even a year. How does it work now with all the the things changing? How can you just give a price at the moment?
Yeah, that is hard work. You say it correct. There are so many elements which are changing. I was just before this meeting started, I saw our coffee supplier just send us an email. Yeah, all prices will go up between 10 and 15%. Yeah, that's it. Okay, it's coffee, cups of coffee per day. But anyway, it's just all over everything. The cost for the grower, cost of fertilizer, packaging, boxes, buckets, flowers, gas to grow the flowers, electricity. All the elements, transport, air freight, everything is going up. The way we handle it, and yeah, it sounds easy, but it's not easy, is to discuss it openly with customers, with retailers. This is the situation. Where can you help? Some growers, some retailers said, okay, let's change the contents of a bunch. We all have heard probably the change of prices of tulips, that some retailers have decided to take out a stem to go to 9 stems. Some retailers are looking at reducing the size of the bunch. Some retailers said, no, I don't want to change the size of the bunch because it has been successful. I will look myself if I can change my margin or if I increase the price, if possible, to the consumer. So it is. Yeah, some, but also there are retailers in, let's say, within a contract period of a year, they say after 9 months, they say, yeah, it's your problem. And that's hard work.
Yeah, I can imagine, especially like you talked about the air freight prices going up so much. Yeah. Gas prices in Holland, they are through the roof at the moment. A lot of panic. I can imagine a lot of growers will not even give you prices at the moment.
No, true. They say, I'll wait. I will give you prices in summer in January when I know more.
Yeah. Wow, it's really difficult. Well, yeah, just giving a price for a whole year. Normally, I think in a normal market, it was already challenging.
Yeah, because then they were looking at market prices for a whole year or so, and they took an average and... Or they worked from cost prices, cost price plus. This is my cost price. I want to have a return 20% to the farm, whatever.
Yeah.
But now you don't know the cost price.
Yeah, it's all.
So where do we start?
Yeah.
Cost price can be different, completely different.
Yeah. In America, South America, we see the trend that a lot of big packers or bouquet makers are buying farms also just to get... the amount of flowers in. Is that something you could see happening as well in Africa or in Europe?
In Kenya, farms have been bought by big companies. So you can see that's happening. We also see some of the trading companies, they get closer to production by making special deals, exclusive deals, or paying for whatever financing. So they link themselves more to production, which there are two ways. Okay, you can say, okay, when you buy a farm, you have the production. When you link up to growers or you start paying or investing in farms, you will be more on the number one position. On the other end, yeah, we believe more in independent partnerships, not to take more than 50% of a farm, I would say.
Yeah.
For both sides, you never know what happened. You can lose really big contracts from 1 year to another. We've seen it happening in the last 2-3 years.
Yep.
And if you are linked as a farm to it, you also are linked to that contract.
Yeah, I mean it's flower business. If you stop supplying, don't stop talking, because probably you'll get the contract back in 1 or 2 years again.
Yes, so. Exactly.
It's the way it happens, and Yeah, let's hope the market stabilizes. I think that's really important. I don't think that the gas prices will go back to a level we have seen last year or 2 years ago. Like you already said, everything is going up, all the prices are going up. I think luckily the consumer sees that everything is more expensive, and as we have seen, they are willing to pay for it, for the flowers.
Yeah, but of course there is a limit. Huh? There is, so also people expect after an increase some stabilization. Also if consumers are hit by higher costs on everything, do they still have the same amount of money left for flowers in a wallet?
Yeah, I mean, when they were sitting at home, they couldn't go to restaurants, bars, on holidays, that they had some money to spend. And luckily it went to flowers. I mean, it helped our industry enormously. And let's hope it's in people's minds as well. I mean, in springtime, twice they did their garden, they planted all kinds of things in their garden. Hopefully it's in their mindset now, so they will do it next spring as well. And buying flowers just at home, just to give them joy. Let's hope it's in their mindset, but for sure it's not going to be on the same levels as it was during the pandemic, because they have more ways to spend it again.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. One other thing, we have a lot of florists watching this show as well. Some of them are complaining about the big supermarkets, because it's difficult for them to sell flowers, because the supermarkets most of the time sell cheaper. How can they have a good living as a florist? What would you say? I mean, you're an insider, you know what's happening at supermarkets, but also at chains as well. Mm-hmm. How can they make a good living out of being a florist?
Yeah, that's always a good question, I would say. Of course, it's differentiation. Try to offer differently. I think the florists are the most creative persons in our industry. They are very creative. Normally, let's say there are exceptions, but there are a lot of florists are also not so good in calculating. So it's still important that they also calculate, that they are also commercial, not just nice to make and giving it away, but they still need to make the money. But be creative, keep calculating yourself, of course. Yeah. And follow the trends, in other markets, and try to take advantage in your own market. You know, it's good to see also this kind of media, where we are now, but also through Instagram, through all kinds of other places, to follow what's going on and try to implement locally.
Yeah.
I mean, and do things with florists or supermarkets, they cannot react that fast.
Yeah, that's also true. I mean, and sometimes it sounds a bit boring, but think outside the box.
Yes.
Because and that's literally because supermarkets get supplied in boxes. If you make something that doesn't fit in a box, you will have something that's not available in the supermarket.
Yeah. Don't try to copy the supermarkets. The supermarkets should try to copy you.
Yeah. Oh, that's a good one. That's a good one to wrap this this flower circus talks up.
Okay.
Tom, I would like to thank you for all the knowledge and the information you shared with us. Keep on doing the good work, supplying the world with beautiful flowers, your sustainability projects, and let's hope we meet in person soon. Hopefully I can see you at the IFTF or at the trade fair in Holland.
Yes.
Okay, and thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you everybody for watching. Hope to see you next week for a new Flower Circus Talks. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.